appreciate that, Elizabeth. Thank you so much. So now, I'd like to bring on Glenn Martin, Vice President of Development and Public Affairs and Director of the David Rothenberg Center for Public Policy at the Fortune Society, one of our co-sponsors. Glenn will summarize the issues that brought us here today and will set the tone for the day.
Good morning. Nothing intimidating about this space. So, I am going to try to set the tone for today, but I think I'd be remiss as a sponsor not to thank certain folks before we get started, and I'll be brief. The planning committee, including Mansfield Frazier and Ronald Day and Nina Saxon, all of the volunteers that helped make today happen, the board staff of the Fortune Society, the agency where I work, our co-sponsors for today's event, the College and Community Fellowship, and the Manhattan Borough President's Office. And of course, a special thank you to the Think Outside the Cell Foundation, Joe Robinson, and of course, Sheila Rule. And especially Sheila for continuing to create spaces for people who have done time in prison, like myself, to have a voice. Thank you, Sheila. I'd like to thank our media partners, Black Enterprise and Hot 97, and the Ford Foundation, of course, and the panelists that you'll be hearing from today. We've assembled essentially what I see as some of the most courageous and brilliant thinkers on these issues from around the state and around the country. And thank you to Riverside Church and the Riverside Prison Ministry for allowing us to use this amazing space, a space where we've seen many historic speeches, a space where Martin Luther King has spoken, a space for people who care about social justice. And if you care about social justice, then prisons are the belly of the beast. So my charge is to set the tone. And as I wrote my speech, I thought about the title of today's event, Think Outside the Cell, A New Day, A New Way. And it served as my guide in drafting the speech. 2.2 million people in prisons and jails. 730,000 coming home this year. 7 million under some form of criminal justice supervision. And we're at ground zero, Upper Manhattan, one of the communities disproportionately impacted by the criminal justice system. And if you don't believe me, after today's event, just take a walk up Lenox Avenue and you'll see the guard towers, the NYPD prison towers that we erect in response to crime. Poverty and addiction are treated as incurable cancers in the United States. And prisons are the fear-driven quarantine facilities that have allowed us all to sleep at night. As we know, the United States has the highest documented incarceration rate and total prison population in the world. Even as research demonstrates that much of what is defined as crime in the United States is fueled by drug and alcohol addiction and mental health problems. When race is considered, the rate by which the United States incarcerates its citizens is shameful, nor does it correlate with documented criminal behavior. The extraordinary magnitude of incarceration and the stark disparity in rates of incarceration by race means that each black man in this audience has a 1 in 3 chance of going to prison in his lifetime. Speak to anyone of color in New York and you can be sure they have a close friend or relative in prison. I can assure you, this is not true in most of Manhattan. In fact, recent statistics suggest that the rate of incarceration of women of color is actually on the rise. We, as a society, have made a deliberate choice to address a history of poverty, neglect, racism, and classism by creating penal codes rather than solutions. One segment of America gets learned and earned, and another segment gets stopped and frisked. We've not worked to solve the root causes of the problem. In a country that can put a man on the moon and a black man in the White House, our approach to crime has been intellectually and morally lacking. It is both ineffective and unjust. Furthermore, as we know in the Fortune Society, our nation's thirst for punishment and revenge doesn't end when people leave prison. As Michelle Alexander crystallized for us in her new book, The New Jim Crow, each year, millions of poor people of color with criminal records return to their communities as a newly manufactured underclass of citizens. Try as they may to reintegrate into mainstream society, they face a maze of policies and regulations that keep them from accessing the very things they need to rebuild their lives and become functioning members of society. Legal and statutory restrictions, inadvertent and deliberate discrimination, and cultural stigma associated with having a criminal record restrict formerly incarcerated people from obtaining basic needs. Find a job, but you cannot work here. Find a stable home, but you cannot live here. Educate yourself, but you cannot go to school here. The hypocrisy is blatant. Teresa, one of the first clients I worked with when arriving at the Fortune Society, had decided that after 32 arrests for drug possession and prostitution, that she wanted to change her life. She knew she had had enough. Within 5 years, Teresa earned her GED on Rikers Island, became sober, went on to earn her undergraduate degree at Baruch College, and then her master's degree in social work at NYU. She then landed an amazing job helping other people to regain their lives and their dignity. And her boss decided to promote her to management. When she applied for her social worker's license, a prerequisite for the new job, she was denied by the state of New York and was told that she lacked good moral character. The state of New York got it wrong. The hurdles Teresa conquered to turn her life around speaks volumes about the resilience of the human spirit and should have been applauded by New York State. Evidence suggests that employment can reduce recidivism. It makes sense. Being able to make ends meet means less temptation to throw a brick. And if you don't know what throw a brick means, ask someone in the pew next to you. You're in Harlem, I'm sure folks know what it means. I had the opportunity to do a radio interview yesterday with Prince, a young man in Fortune's Employment Services program. Prince is charismatic, intelligent, and entrepreneurial. Yet when he arrived at Fortune, he could not get through the door to an employer to prove himself. Why? Because he had committed a crime when he was 17. We don't allow people to drink at the age of 17, but we're willing to ship Prince off at the age of 16 to an adult prison in upstate New York and brand him with a scarlet letter for the rest of his life. Why? So that those upstate communities can experience sustained economic growth? Wasn't 400 years of that practice enough? As our society becomes more stratified, unemployment remains high, and living wage manufacturing jobs continue to diminish. Higher education becomes necessary, and yet individuals in prisons are denied access to Pell Grants. Legal barriers exist in accessing public housing and other public benefits. Formerly incarcerated people are not full citizens in some state. They cannot vote. And for those who think there is no value in the vote, ask yourself, if the vote has no meaning, why would they take it away? When these individuals inevitably fail to successfully reintegrate, they're not the only ones who suffer. So do their families, communities, and indeed the entire country. Let's think about this for a moment. Much of American society is impacted by the consequences of over-incarceration. Hundreds of thousands return each year, and these individuals return to millions more family members, many of whom are already burdened by poverty and neglect. Every year, there's an exponential impact. Valuable lives are wasted, communities are strained, the public is less safe, and dreams are deferred. And yet, as we watch this go on, in the 2004 State of the Union address, President Bush provided a ray of hope. Could it be the tides were changing? Then President Bush announced his Prisoner Reentry Initiative. He reminded America that over 650,000 people were due to be released to our communities from state and federal prisons that year. And while the concept of prisoner reentry was already germinating in the halls of the United States Department of Justice, President Bush transcended traditional political rhetoric and declared that America is the land of second chances. And when the gates of the prison open, the path ahead should lead to a better life. That important pronunciation by an unsuspected ally of the progressive criminal justice reform movement led to a number of meaningful shifts in the distribution of scarce resources and in local and national policy. Bipartisan dialogue in Congress culminated in the passage of the Second Chance Act. States and localities adopted reentry as a critical component of efforts to increase public safety, and many jurisdictions began to revisit the collateral consequences that served to alienate and unfairly diminish opportunities for formerly incarcerated people. In fact, over the 7 years since that speech, reentry mania has swept across our nation. Reentry has been adopted by many as the proverbial cure-all vaccination for our country's addiction to mass incarceration. If you believe in tipping points, perhaps the bipartisan attention on reentry was such a tipping point, and we're on our way to a totally redefined, race-neutral, equitable criminal justice system in America, one that viewed each instance of victimization and subsequent incarceration as not just the failure of the defendant, but also a failure by society. The inherent flaw in this thinking is that it means waiting on the banks downstream to collect and mend the bodies of young, poor, Black and Latino men and women who are chewed up and spit out by our unforgiving prison system. Good morning. Nothing intimidating about this space. So, I am going to try to set the tone for today, but
one of our co-sponsors. Glenn will summarize the issues that brought us here today and will set the tone for the day.
Staff of the Fortune Society agency where I work. Our co-sponsors for today's event, the College and Community Fellowship and the Manhattan Borough President's Office. And of course, a special thank you to the Think Outside the Cell Foundation.
Appreciate that, Elizabeth. Thank you so much. So now, I'd like to bring on Glenn Martin, Vice President of Development and Public Affairs and Director of the David Rothenberg Center for Public Policy at the Fortune Center.
I think I'd be remiss as a sponsor not to thank certain folks before we get started, and I'll be brief. The Planning Committee, including Mansfield Frazier and Ronald Day and Nina Saxon, all of the volunteers that helped make today happen, the board staff.